Good evening, and thank you for tuning in to this special edition of Birth in the Kingdom. I am your host, Apostle Larry Fisher, and tonight is a wonderful night. Tonight is the night that we are premiering in this special presentation, the launch broadcast, the launch show for Life Beyond Limits with our host, Sandy Norman. God bless you, Prophet.
God bless you, Apostle.
Amen.
God bless you.
God bless you. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Now, most people are accustomed to me being on live at this time.
Yes.
But we threw them a little curve tonight. Amen?
Amen.
And because you wanted to come out with a bang, and we wanted everybody to know about your new broadcast, so we thank God for you. And then thank you for asking me to host. I'm honored to be able to host. But I want the audience tonight to get to know a little bit about who you are. So we just want you to look into the camera and just tell us about who you are and tell us about this exciting new broadcast that's going to be coming.
Praise the Lord. My name is Prophetess Sandy Norman, and I thank you all for tuning in on tonight. The program or the platform that God has given me is called Life Beyond Limits, where success makes its own statement. Tonight, as we premiere, one of the things that the Lord placed upon my heart was the men. And so one of the things prophetically God spoke to me, even as, you know, we have so many different things that are happening around the nations. You know, we've had, you know, a shift not only, you know, in America, but we have so many things that are taking place globally. And even in the city of Chicago, we have, you know, we've had marches where we've seen, you know, hundreds of thousands of women that have, you know, stormed the streets of Chicago. We've seen, you know, marches and rallies, you know, concerning the Donald Trump, you know, presidency. And the Lord, you know, put it upon my heart basically to just, you know, to bring the men out. And the Bible says that the men are, you know, the priesthood. And so, you know, just with everything that has, you know, been transpiring, the Lord said to me that, you know, we need the men, you know, to begin to speak. You know, we've seen, you know, people just come together on a global platform. We've seen, you know, the homosexuals. We've seen, you know, the women. And God said to me, you know, to do this show pretty much on today, because we as the body of Christ, we need to do the same thing. We need to come together as one. We need to be, you know, out in the streets, you know, active, just as we see, you know, the other movements that are taking place. And so the Lord said to me, he said, gather the men. And the vision that God has given me is a global vision. And I wanted to bring together, you know, not just, you know, African-American men, but we have, you know, African men. We have Italian. You know, we just want to see, or I wanted to see just men, you know, come together. As one, you know, as one body. And so the Bible says that, you know, he's the God of every tongue, tribe, and every nation. And I believe that even as we, you know, are moving forward, we're going to have to, you know, bridge as men and women of God on a global scale if we're going to see breakthrough and if we're going to see change. And so this is what, you know, the vision that the Lord gave for me to launch this show on tonight, you know, to bring the men together as head. And me being a woman, you know, I'm a part of that as well. So basically tonight we just want to, you know, come together as one, as the body of Christ, men and women of God. But most importantly, even in the city of Chicago with all the violence that's taking place, you know, the men need to speak. And so the theme now is not the time to remain silent. And so the Lord had me to gather, you know, a great group of apostles in the city of Chicago just to come together, you know, to basically say, what is God saying, you know, not only for the season, but what is God speaking, you know, to the men? And even in, you know, Chicago, it's almost like our young men have become endangered species, you know, in a sense, with all the killings, with all the murders, with all the violence. And so, you know, it's just time for the men to come forth, every tongue, every tribe, and every nation. And so I have, you know, the men here on tonight, you know, to represent, and they'll introduce themselves to you on tonight. Amen. 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 Apostle.
Right. It's an honor to be here. We give God praise. My name is Aquilus Ricks. I'm from Liberia, West Africa. Graduated of the Moody Bible Institute in the year 2000. I have a master's in public administration. I'm doing a PhD in public policy. My wife and I have a ministry, Barnabas Global Outreach. Pretty much our vision is to partner with churches and organizations in prayer and spiritual warfare. That's where the grace is. That's where the passion is. And we believe that it's about time that the kingdom fight back. We believe that we live in a time that we want to activate young men, women, people in general to enter into the spiritual realm and take hold of destiny, purpose, and meaning. And so it's a pleasure to be here with Woman of God. We really appreciate the invitation, and we look forward to the discussion tonight.
Amen.
Awesome.
Amen.
Awesome.
Amen. Good evening, everyone. I am Apostle Ernest Tabe. I'm in Joliet. I am originally from Cameroon, West Africa.
Hallelujah.
What I do, I'm a deliverance minister. And this is what I've done all my life, being a gatekeeper, and being a watchman of the city, and having been tried, proved, and tested. I think this is an honor to come and give the key to the young men on how to go about this. So I am the senior pastor of River of Life Deliverance International Ministry with a headquarter in Joliet. And I'm here tonight as a professional. I'm a tax professional, and I'm still at the Global University, still doing theology to perfect that which God has put it in me. But there is enough tangible evidence to prove that this is the time for us to come out and give the solution for such a time as this.
Amen.
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 Amen. Amen. Pastor Rogers.
Hi, my name is Apostle David Rogers. My wife and I are the senior pastors of the House of Prayer for All Nations Ministries, and we're the overseers of the Dominion Vision Fellowship International. Our primary responsibility in ministry in this hour is we train churches to do evangelism, leadership, and discipleship. We've traveled the world, and we noticed that churches don't even disciple people anymore. So in that ignorance gap in the church has been depowered. And so we have services, we have conferences, we have gatherings, but we're absent from the engagement on the streets. And so we train churches to go out, minister the gospel, cast devils, heal the sick, and then bring people into the church to disciple them. And the second part of our assignment is economic development. We have Dominion Vision Community Development Group, where we teach people how to build generational wealth through real estate. And glad to be here, glad to be here with these men of God, and glad to be a part of the show.
God bless you. I'm Apostle John Zartucci, my father's House of Nations, International School of Ministry, as well as Storm International. Involved primarily is I'm just so blessed to hear these men and women of God, and to be here with Apostle Larry. But to hear Apostle Rogers talk, it's in the same vein, is to be able to help reconstruct men and to come back. I believe that one of the biggest problems that I faced in traveling several nations throughout my ministry. This year we'll be heading towards Bulgaria and throughout Macedonia, Turkey, and Ukraine, and we got several invitations for there, so we'll be there this year as well as Africa again. The thing that I've seen is there's lack of discipleship. We've got the so-called Christians, and the Christians are more of the problem for us because we're not building disciples. Christians are flippant back and forth. They have no stability, no roots. Very, very unstable. One of the things that I believe that has taken place throughout the church is the church itself, let me kind of equate it to the city. We've got a city without a vision. We've got a nation that's lost its vision. I believe the church has lost its vision, even to winning souls and making disciples. We're building buildings and putting people in them, taking up offerings and having gatherings, but we're not making disciples and reproducing and giving the next generation nothing. So my heart in the ministry is to make disciples of men, to win souls, and to begin to, again, to be cliche, is to catch the fish, but clean them and make them what they're supposed to be, and to empower them with Deuteronomy 8:18, to create. No one gives you anything. You were designed to create, to bring forth. And we want to develop that inside of your life. In Chicago, it's not about killing. It's about no life matters. It's about everyone lives matter, of course. However, it's not about lives. It's about class. And what class you're in will determine if you live or not. So this is what God has begun to speak to me. And so we want to bring our people back to the place they're supposed to be in Christ.
Amen. Wow, that's good. Well, you certainly have heard from God because you have assembled a great panel here. We got a lot to talk about. And yes. I made the statement earlier, you know, I don't know what I'm doing here, but hearing what they all said is truly in vain with what we're talking about and what we've been teaching in our ministry as well. And when I heard you talking, and all of you actually, what the Lord gave us was evangelism, discipleship, and training.
Yes.
Because that's how we're going to make the church effective in what we're supposed to be doing. So we're really focusing on evangelism, going out, winning souls, again, and then making disciples out of them through our training in Scripture, in the Bible, and then actual physical training, going out and doing what we do. So this is a time, and we actually have a crusade that begins this month. It's called the Cross Crusade. Evangelists arise, because what I've saw, and what the Lord has shown me is that we've lost. We can't find our evangelists. We got our apostles, and we got our prophets, but. And we got our pastors and our teachers, but where are our evangelists?
Absolutely.
And so I think that what happens is we got a lot of gifted evangelists who have put their evangelist cap on the shelf, and they prefer to be a prophet. They prefer to flow in as an apostle or whatever. And so this is really important that you're speaking on this. And the fact that you're the only woman doesn't speak to the idea that women are not effective in what they're doing. They're not conscious or not caring. But this is the time that God has called for us tonight. So I'm just excited about what will be talked about. So, Apostle,
Amen. Amen. That's really powerful, very rich. Amen. And Apostle, if I may add, we've exchanged our gifts for audience. Mm-hmm. And this is what one of the most confusing elements in the church, intercession, gift of prophecy, and the office of a prophet. All three are capable of seeing. But notoriety, well, you're apostle or prophet, you get more notoriety, you get more platform. So an evangelist is really not in style, is not vogue. So we kind of put it in the back. So we've exchanged that gift and that anointing for an audience. And I do believe that when you have to exchange your gift for an audience, change the audience.
Mm. Hallelujah. Jesus.
Don't you let your gift go.
Yes.
That is what God, change the audience, get rid of the audience, find an audience that wants that gift. And it's so vitally important because there is a people who desire it. Richard Branson, billionaire, Virgin Airlines, is hiring all ex-felons right now and putting them to work. Didn't wait for them to get clean. I'm cleaning you in the process.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Hallelujah.
Wow. So part of our evangelism is to put them back to work, the subungent, to get these people back, these ex-felons, get them off the street. Yeah. We need to house them. We talk about humanity and injustice. These are the things that we really need to evangelize with also. These are the tools that are needed, not just Jesus loves you.
That's right. Amen. Praise God. Amen.
Please forgive me, prophet. Just go right ahead.
I mean, this is a free flow. We want, you know, the Holy Spirit to move on tonight on this platform. And so, I mean, everything that you're saying is the will of God.
Yes,
so
yes, yes,
we want to
yes.
just, you know, allow God to move as he would. Allow the voice of the Holy Spirit to speak. But even as you talk about evangelism, as I was saying earlier, we have, you know, you see everybody in the street doing their own form of evangelism. You see the homosexuals, they're out there, you know, in full force. They're out there, you know, in power. You know, they're speaking about, you know, what they believe. They're, you know, they're advancing their kingdom, as I would, you know, like to say. And even as I pointed out earlier, we have all these different, you know, marches in the city of Chicago. And it's like, where is the church at? You know, if the people are in the streets, you know, why are we still inside of the church building? Why are we not rallying out on the streets? You know, why are we not, you know, evangelizing? Why are we not seeing, you know, more moves of God? You know, the Bible said the children of the world are wiser, you know.
Can I answer
yes,
that?
Sir.
Prior to the show, you asked what was the word of the Lord
yes.
for 2017. And the word of the Lord for 2017 is distinction. For ages, we've called everything the church simply because it had a choir, a pulpit, and a message. Everything does not qualify to be called church. There are distinguishing marks that make a real New Testament church. When we look at the book of Acts, there were four pillars of their culture. They addressed and were connected to the apostles' doctrine. That's the doctrine of the kingdom of God. Mm-hmm. Secondly, they had fellowship. That koinonia, it also deals with unity.
Yes.
They had breaking of bread, which dealt with communion. Community. A church is a community. It's not an organization. It's not a place where you go to become a big shot. It's a community, which means we have to be connected to a community to create a community. And lastly, it said prayer. All of those things germinated in the single greatest movement of population known to mankind. It started off as 120 people committed to a 10-day prayer session. It morphed into almost 20 million people in just 200 years through evangelism. They evangelized entire cities. Yeah. So here in Chicago, we have more churches per square foot than any place on planet Earth. We've got all these churches, we have all these gatherings, but when we look at the qualifications for what you call church, most of them don't meet the mark. There is no understanding of the kingdom, there is no fellowship, there is no communion, and there definitely is no prayer. Because if you are really praying, you would have heard God say, go out and evangelize this city.
Yes.
Police will not change it. I was a police officer for 7 years. I worked in Inglewood for 3 years. I worked in Robert Taylor for 4 years. We ran around. We chased criminals all day long. Incarceration does not reform people. The only thing that will change what is going on in this city and cities like Chicago is the power of the gospel coming from real church, real Christians who have experienced real conversion, real encounter with Jesus. We can do everything else. We do it. We do jobs. We do economic development, all that stuff. But if it's not built on a firm foundation of relationship with Christ, we're going to keep spinning our wheels.
Wow. I want to zero in on the whole aspect of the men, you know, getting men, you know, involved in the things of God, you know. And one of the things the Lord dealt with my spirit about as I was preparing was from John chapter 6. We know the unique parable about Jesus feeding the 5,000. And the Spirit of God moved me to read that story again. And it was something amazing I came up with, that I discovered, you know. And what it tells us is that there comes a young boy with 5 loaves and 2 fishes. And the disciple says, you know, what are these for so many? And Jesus' response was interesting. In verse 10 of John 6, Jesus says, make the men sit down. Now, it's interesting. He brings bread and fish to feed the thousands, and Jesus signals out the men. He said, make the men sit down. And the Bible says they sat down where there were much grass in the place. Mm-hmm. Why? Lord, the bread and fish was to feed everybody. Why did you single out the men? Why do you single out, make the men sit down in a grassy place? And that it comes down to verse 14. It says, now we know the miracle took place. It says, then those men, when they have seen the miracle, they said, truly, this is the prophet that should come into the world. And the next thing, what? They wanted to make Jesus king by force. Now, the Spirit of God showed me something that was strategic. When we can get men to sit down and get them to understand God has something to give them. There is a bread, there is a fish. God has something to meet their need, to fill that gap, their hunger, their thirst. If we can only get them to sit down, God will give them so much there will be an overflow. There were 12 baskets left. And when God gets through feeding them, the Bible says two things happen. They will acknowledge him as Lord, and they will want to make him king over their families, over the nation. That's where I believe the call of God on my life, and I believe these men, that's where the call is. The vision is to get men to sit down. Men by nature, the Spirit of God told me in the Genesis chapter 1, man of God, verse 26, about the creation of men. He gave us what? Dominion. Men by nature is attracted to power and dominion. That's how he was created. Until he see the manifestation of dominion and power, he cannot submit. He was created as a person to operate in power and dominion. So everything, even in ministry, that's what I believe the trend God is moving us to now is that the church need to begin to covet spiritual gifts more. We need to get after the spiritual gifts. Men are not just interested in words. Words only will not bring a man to his knee. He got to see the power of God confronting the power of the enemy and breaking principalities and powers, rulers of the darkness of this world, spiritual wickedness in high places. He got to see God confronting the kingdom of darkness and overcoming. Yes. When a man see the power of God at work, miracles flowing, healing flowing, yes, he will submit.
Amen.
He's attracted to power and dominion.
Yes.
That's how he was created.
Amen.
And men, woman of God, that's my passion. That's why I pray the way I pray, because I believe when we fight in the spiritual realm,
yes,
when we come against the spiritual forces that hang over the whole community, that suppress men, that keep them in bondage, when we begin to pray that the spiritual eyes will be open and God begin to move supernaturally through us, men will be, wow, what is this? What is happening? I want to learn more about this thing. It will bring them. And when God breaks them, I'm telling you, they will not only declare his Lord, they will try to make him king over this nation. Men will take the forefront to Amen. Make Jesus king and Lord in the nation.
Amen. 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 Yes. Thank God. Yes.
See, I am overwhelmed by the contribution about what is about to happen. The next phase of 2017. See, I heard you loud and clear. That men need to arise. Yes. Isaiah chapter 60 says, arise and shine.
Yes.
You see, men need to arise and occupy it. Mm-hmm. But you cannot occupy a territory that you have not conquered.
Yes.
Before you lift up your flag, you must be confident that you have conquered the enemies,
yes,
and then you can claim possession of the land.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. And you see, Ecclesiastes chapter 10 and verse 8. You see, when the hedge is broken, the serpent bites.
Mm-hmm.
The men are the herd of the family, yes, and they are nowhere to be found. The hedge has been broken, and the serpent, who has three options, to kill, to steal, and to destroy, is working very, very hard to keep the men in bondage. Yes. And the way the system is programmed, I'm an African man.
Yes.
With my knowledge of deliverance, I have three mandates: to set the captives free,
yes,
to reverse the dead works, and to rebuild the body of Christ. When I see men who are supposed to be the intercessors, who are supposed to be the head of the house, and they are nowhere to be found because of the way the system has marginalized, has kept men in bondage.
Yes.
So at this time, looking at that, and when men are missing, the house is open.
Yes.
That's why there is violence, because the young people are fighting using the wrong weapons. They are fighting a battle that they don't understand.
Yes.
Somebody wrote something on Facebook recently, and I read it. When I read it, I responded instantly. He wrote, he said, is it a good thing for pastors to move about with loaded guns? Like you rightly say, you have been a police officer for 7 years.
Yes, sir.
How many of you know that the arm of flesh has failed?
Yes.
The arm of flesh has no guarantee. It is... He who fight by the sword shall die by the sword.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
The arm of flesh has failed. And nothing can happen to you physically without it happening to you spiritually first. Nobody can kill you physically without him killing you spiritually.
Yes.
Nobody can arrest you physically without him arresting you spiritually. So I am here to give the supernatural for the men to arise. Because the supernatural part of it has been neglected. I am not just talking as a clinging cymbal or a sounding gong. I'm talking from a practical perspective.
Yes.
From a perspective of a deliverance minister. You see, God has given the mandate to set the men free.
Yes.
To set the men free. And there are many groups that are out there that are bringing men together. Why is Chicago going through all the murder? All the shootings. The police cannot do anything.
Nothing.
The government cannot do anything.
Nothing.
In every family, there is a watchman in every family. Somebody needs to arise in the family and take the position and assume their believer's authority to put an end to the shooting.
You know, I started to do an issue here, the year of the Father. It's the spiritual leadership. Mm-hmm. We've got titles rather than the fathers. Titles aren't necessarily fathers, but fathers can carry that title. I love what you brought up, and I've shared that before, ironically. And here it is, Christ says to his apostles. And I have this thing where God does not feed man. He gave apostles to feed them. It is the responsibility. We've got this idea of this Christian. Even the Christian realm is wrong. We are Zoe. We are kingdom. We are a kingdom. For example, if David Rogers goes into the city of Chicago, this is kingdom that's fighting against kingdom, because we're not under the auspices of any kingdom except the one that has sent us. We are kingdom people. We are Zoe people. We are God's people. We have the Zoe life. We can only use the weapons of God, and that is love, that is prayer. Most of the time, we go out without even being prayed. We think God is just going to be the shield, but we're not prayed up. We got pastors that don't know what fasting is. And I'm not saying that we legalistically have to fast for everything, but I believe we don't even need God to tell us when to fast. We ought to be mature enough to know when to fast. We should be mature enough to know that I need to pray. There's some things we can let go, some things we cannot. And we've got to take hold of the altar by virtue of, what is the word saying? He told the disciples, make the men sit down. And ironically, the grass, the men have to have somewhere where they can sit. We have called Christians, if you will, sheep, dumb sheep. Well, dumb sheep are not dumb sheep. Number one, sheep, if there's no grass, they'll jump the fence to go eat where it's at. Now you want to accuse me of stealing the sheep because you've given them a turf, a synthetic, instead of me feeding them the grass that is there, that is apostolic meat.
Yes.
So now I'm a thief. Now I'm blackballed or labeled because I have your sheep that are starving to death. Now I have to feed them my grass to put the wool back on for you to take them back to shave them clean again.
All right.
And this is how it is. And then by guilt and by witchcraft, we want to beat them up and call them back. And God is raising this up where men are going to make men. This is the year of the Father. You know, you save a house, if you save a house, you save a woman. If you save the woman, you save a man, you save a city. And this is what God wants, that man part to be raised back up and to know that he's been made to create wealth. He's been given power to do this.
That's right.
It's unlimited. We go to the moon, but we can't get the city saved.
And I want to talk about this because what has happened in the church and why we have to have distinction. Everybody knows the problem. Everybody. I don't care what city you go to. They have symposiums. They have workshops. I've been in 2,000 meetings. I prayed to God. I said, God, I don't want to go to another meeting about what's happening with us. Here's the distinction. Jesus made the men to sit down in companies of 50. So there had to be structure. Jesus breaks the bread, then he gives it to the apostles give it to the body. Amen. Here's our problem. Acts chapter 8:1, the Bible says the persecution hit the church. Everybody left Jerusalem under persecution except the apostles. The ones to whom which were given the responsibility to rescue the city are not present in the city. I would love to come here and we can throw all of the scriptures out and all that stuff. All that's cute. The reality is, who's going to leave their church and go outside where these kids are and do what Jesus did? Acts 10:38 says, Jesus went about doing good, healing all who were sick, because he was anointed by God with the Holy Ghost and with power. He went out and healed the sick. He cast out devils. What we do is we get inside of a building and that's where we stay. Even the apostles, the sent ones, think being sent means going to a church and standing in a pulpit. Our kids are outside dying. They are dying. 100 shot per week And we having $250 registration fee conferences and hotels, and it's not even in the city. We can't get people to come outside because the culture of our church says we don't care. And until we really address how we present Christ and his kingdom to the world, that's why they're not coming, because we're not going to get them. The command was to go. We keep gathering. And then when you say, okay, we're going out Saturday, well, I gotta do this. Man, what is more important than bringing salvation and deliverance to our sons?
Especially to one who's full-time ministry. And that's the key.
I don't understand it. No. I got saved. I was a four-corner hustler. I was gangbanging. My apostle came outside. I got saved my junior year in high school. I've been 30 years in the kingdom, praying, crying, God, please raise up some real apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers that's going to come outside.
Amen.
Wow. I want to just chime in, too. There's 2 points I want to make, because you mentioned about the fathers. And what I'm understanding also is that the leaders, those that God has called to be leaders, whether they be apostles or whatever, their hearts have to mirror Christ's heart.
Amen. Absolutely. Amen.
And when we understand Christ's heart, the mirror of Christ's heart is the main core of his heart was compassion.
Yes.
We see it in the Father, because he so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son. We see the compassion of the Father for those that he would rescue through his Son dying for us. That speaks to compassion. So when we talk, someone said a little while ago, what's missing? What do we don't see? We don't see the compassion, because there is no real true evangelism when there's no compassion.
Compassion, absolutely.
We can go through the motions, we can be robotic, but in the spirit realm, nothing's happening. It takes the move of someone whose heart mirrors the heart of God, the heart of Christ. I was reading the other day, just yesterday, and the Bible talks about Paul. Paul at one point was willing to give up his own salvation so that his people would be saved.
Yes.
Compassion. It mirrors Christ.
Yes.
Christ was willing to give up his life so that the world would be saved.
Absolutely.
You see, the Father was willing to give up his Son.
Amen.
So why aren't we not following that pattern? And so
when we were
young and someone said, well, what's missing? I'm saying what's missing is that the stirring up of the evangelists in our ministries. See, when I was younger, the evangelists came to town.
Mm-hmm. Always.
For two days, ended up staying 2 weeks. Mm-hmm. Because people were constantly getting saved.
Yeah.
They couldn't leave. Now, it's not the evangelist that comes to town, it's the prophet.
Mm-hmm.
We're not knocking the gifts. We know we need the gifts. But those gifts are for the perfecting of the saints. Mm-hmm. And we need the stirring in the house so we can see the compassion again. Because, and I'm probably going to get in trouble with this one, but I thank God for the prayer movement.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But some of the people that are at the heads of those movements who have the most influence, we can't find them where the real problem is.
No.
Okay, so
it's much easier said than done.
I'm sorry?
It is much easier said than
exactly.
done.
Exactly. So we're behind the walls,
right,
and we have the most influence. Mm-hmm. Imagine someone who's world-renowned going to the streets where the real problem is. That in itself speaks volumes to those that we're trying to reach, because it says that this person who doesn't have to come cared enough to come from their shielded, fortified place, their place of wealth and all their stuff.
Yeah.
But I'm coming to see about you.
But here's the distinction we got to make. Revelation 2 and 2 says we have to try those which say they are apostles and are not.
Right.
There's a lot of people claiming salvation. How do you have salvation and the love of God does not move you at one point in a whole 365-year, 24-hour day period to go outside one time?
Yes. Right.
Here is Jesus coming all the way from heaven, taking off glory to dwell among us. The Bible said the Word was made flesh.
Right.
Where is the conversion of all of our spiritual knowledge into something practical that touches people on the ground where they live at?
I think sometimes we get it mixed up because, you know, what you really say is so profound, because when you look at the scriptures, especially Genesis, okay, the creation,
mm-hmm.
you see, first of all, the progression of things is that the Spirit of God moved over mm-hmm. the face of the deep.
Yes.
And then the Word came, and then things came into existence.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I think one of the emphasis that we place on prayer is that you have to have the Spirit of God moving first. Mm-hmm. That's where prayer comes first. Mm-hmm. Prayer prepares the heart. And then after the prayer meeting, as you rightly said, then what? There should be going forth of the word to see the result, to see the springing forth of things, you know? Yes. You know, but just to piggyback a little bit, you know, I've been praying about Chicago. We know all the stories and the news about Chicago. Mm-hmm. And the Spirit of God showed me something. Because I asked the Lord, I said, why is it Chicago, on the south side and west side, we have the most shootings in the whole city? And it puzzled me, you know? And I got back, I said, Lord, show me, help me to understand why. And the Lord showed me something that amazes me. The south side and the west side has the most churches in the city. Mm-hmm. Yes. So the Spirit of God showed me something. The devil is out to mock and embarrass the church.
He's telling the truth.
Because what people are going to say is this. If Chicago, south side, and west side have all these churches and they pray to Jesus and the Holy Ghost and speak in tongues and everything else, why we have these all this violence in these two sections of the city?
Can I answer you?
Because
why? The Bible says in Proverbs 20, verse 4, the king actually, let me just read it to you clearly here. It says that the king establishes the land by justice. The problem that exists, and I will say this, the so-called gatekeepers of our city are not gatekeepers. They're not equally yoked. They're not linked together. They are selfish. They could care less about each and every one. They stand there on a platform taking offerings like they're all connected and don't give a damn about each other. This is the problem with these so-called gatekeepers. And God is raising up a people that will link together, that are one united people, one faith, one love, one heart, one vision, one Christ Jesus, and the unity of the Spirit that God gave us, not the Spirit that we want to produce. And God says, I'll tear them down to raise up another people. They think that they cannot die. They think because their churches and their followings are big. They think because they have power and the resources to declare something. They think because they can speak from a platform and make everyone turn their face against you. But even the people that they speak to know the truth, but they're afraid to leave. But God is about to set the prisoners free from inside.
See, it is very profound. When the gatekeepers are missing, until the gate open, the King of Glory cannot come.
Come on now.
Oh,
come
yes,
on,
man. Right.
Until the gate swing open, until the satanic gatekeepers are taken down, the King of Glory cannot come in. Mm-hmm. So what you are saying is that fear has kept so many of them bound.
Yes.
And all their congregations.
Fear and all their congregations. So it is time to let them know that that which you are afraid about will come upon you.
Yes.
If you try to preserve your life, you will lose it.
Yeah.
If you lay your life down for Jesus, you will regain your life.
That's Bible. Yeah.
That's right.
Isaiah 26:3. Open the gates. Open the gates.
Lift up
the righteous nation, which keeps the truth,
that's
may
right.
enter in.
Amen. That's right.
Psalm 24, verse 7. Lift up your heads, all ye gates. Be lifted up, ye everlasting doors of the King. Men of God, what the Spirit of God showed me.
For whoever, King of Glory.
Whoever controls the gate controls the city.
Amen. That's right.
Whoever controls the gate
the
controls the city.
The gatekeepers are walking in witchcraft
and
manipulation over our city.
Yes. Whoever controls the gates.
And this is why, and this is why distinction has to be made.
Yes.
When Jesus came, the Pharisees, Sadducees, scribes, and zealots were already in power. They were already in power. So Jesus took a whole chapter in Matthew 23, and he said, woe unto you, Pharisees, Sadducees, scribes, hypocrites. He called them hypocrites. They were two-faced, double-minded. In one side of their tongue, they claim the kingdom. But in the other side, there is no work to bag this faith up. And
Amen.
Instead of us calling it out, because we got too many cowards in the church,
yes.
That's why God bring all these street guys. He get them saved, and he call them to be apostles and prophets, because we're not scared of that church stuff. I'm not scared of your clique. I don't need to be a part of your club. I came out of games. So I didn't come into the kingdom to be a part of another game. I came apart to be the kingdom, and we got to start calling these cowards out because they sleeping with our daughters, they taking offerings, there's no economic development, you riding in BMW 750s and single mothers with children on the bus in the snow trying to get to your service so they can get demonized again. It is time out, and that's why men won't come, because men will not follow hypocrites. And that's why they won't invite guys like you, they won't invite guys
That's right.
Because you're talking about prayer, you're talking about deliverance, that's and right. Sin is how they make money.
We bring the gatekeepers bring in their profits, not God's profits.
Not God's profits.
First Kings, when you look, 400 prophets were before Joseph at, and inside him, he said, "Is there some other prophet
Come
here?
On, is there
there's something
here?
Inside of me. That 400 are lying here.
Yes.
Bring me a prophet that I can hear that inquires of God." Now, 400 prophets that were speaking, you know what? They exchanged their gift for an audience with the king. Resources, money, things. 400 prophets, and there's one man that was anointed by God as a king. He said, "Get me another prophet. There's something that's resident in my spirit that says the 400 are wrong. They missed it. Bring me him. Bring me this man." And here comes the prophet.
Hallelujah.
One man, the majority.
One man
Micaiah. Micaiah changed the entire history by his word to a man that heard his word on the inside and not 400 men that were assembled together.
Let me say something. I like this. You know, we're talking about controlling the spiritual gates. And now whoever controls the gates control the city.
Yes.
Men of God, you said something when you were talking earlier. You talked about Acts chapter 8.
Yes.
About you know, the church being persecuted.
Yes.
Everybody ran away. Only the apostles remain.
Yes.
So Saul did that to the church, right?
Yes.
He discomfited the church. Everybody was scattered. Then in Acts chapter 9, he turned his attention to Damascus.
Yes.
So you know what Saul said? Look, if I can destroy Jerusalem, Damascus is nothing.
Yes.
He went with men to Damascus.
Absolutely.
And what happened as he approached the city? The spiritual gates were open.
Right.
And the glory came down instantly. Yes. And why he thought he would just walk over Damascus? The glory of God intercepted him and knocked him down
because
from the horse.
There were some people praying.
And God, come on now. And God spoke. So what happened? That's why we need to control the spiritual gates.
That's right.
Because Saul was bringing two things to the city. Mm-hmm. Saul was bringing two things to the city of Damascus. He was bringing fear and death.
That's right.
What happened in the city of Chicago? Two things, fear and death.
Yes.
If we don't control the gates, to have to open the gates, that the glory of God will shine down and arrest Saul. Now, when Saul is arrested, the leader of the gangs is arrested, what happens? Saul, men, the Bible says, is too speechless. Mm-hmm. When you pray for the gangbangers, we pray for the leaders of these gangs, that God will shine his glory and arrest them. Their followers will stand speechless, and they will follow suit. And that's why, men of God, women of God, we need to control the gates. That's why we need to activate spiritual gatekeepers to control the gates of the city.
You see, and the best of it all is that God is not a respecter of multitudes. You see, God is not looking for 10,000 people. God is looking for one man.
Yeah. One man.
Three men.
For one man.
With Nebuchadnezzar. Three praying young boys.
Young boys. You see, when Moses sent the 12 spies to go spy the land,
yes,
10 people came back with satanic report.
Yes.
With bad report. But there were two people.
That's awesome right there.
Numbers chapter 14 and verse 9. Caleb and Joshua. The Bible says Caleb and Joshua stood before the congregation and silenced the congregation and told them, say, wait a minute.
Amen.
Number one, do not rebel against the Lord.
Yes.
He said, we are more than able to take over this land. Yes. There must not be any rebellion.
Yes.
Number two, he said, the people of the land, they are like bread for us. We will swallow
Amen.
Them.
Yes.
Numbers chapter 14 and verse 9. He said, we will swallow them. They are bread. Number three, that got my attention that I am going to give right now. You see, most of those gatekeepers don't know that the strong men in the city. Joshua said,
Amen.
God
Amen.
Has removed the protection of the people
in
Jericho.
Yes.
He said, God has removed their scepter. God has removed their armor. God has removed their protection. Yes. God has removed their shield. God has kept them in a place of vulnerability. God has kept them in a place of liability. He said, the battle is the Lord, and the victory is ours. So do not rebel against God, because the land of Chicago is about to be taken over. If somebody can see that the bloodthirsty demons in this land has been arrested,
yes.
God has removed their protection. It is time to arise
yeah.
and to confront the confrontations.
We need to take
Prophet, we need to take a quick station identification. We don't want to break the flow here, but we need to let the people know that just tuned in, you're watching Christ Family Apostolic Network. You are watching the premier broadcast of A Life Beyond Limits with our host, Sandy Norman. I am co-hosting tonight just to help her along, but I want to just say that you have been listening to a lively discussion covering an array of topics here so far. With I think we're focusing on the gates and the necessity for us to control the gates. But I want to say that if you're watching and you've been blessed so far, we want to ask that you would consider sowing a donation to this ministry. We would certainly appreciate it. I don't want to prolong this, but I think there's a ticker going across the bottom of the screen. You can see where to make your donations. I want to get back to this discussion.
Yes.
Okay?
Yes.
Now, and so much has been said so far, but I want to just share something. I was sitting at my computer the other night, and the Lord began to deal with me, because I've been in a lot of services where we have awesome preaching, awesome teaching. We see the flow of the Spirit. We see people getting hands laid on them. We see all kinds of stuff going on. But the service is closed without even an altar call. Now this speaks to all of what we're talking. Because how do you have a church service? Preach the word of God. Lay hands. Speak those things that be not as though they were over people. And you leave them without giving them the opportunity to receive. What was the purpose of the gathering?
That's the distinction.
You said it.
When we have people who are professional churchgoers and they are not saved,
Jesus.
Their ministry is built off of professional churchgoers. Mm-hmm. And so people who have never had any encounter with God, they're not saved.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yes. They just have gone through the motions. Mm-hmm. Matthew 7 says, many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, didn't we prophesy? Didn't we speak in tongues? Didn't we do many wonderful works? He's going to say, depart from me, you worker of iniquity.
Right.
The word iniquity in the Greek means continuous sin. They've never stopped sinning. There was never a repentance.
Mm-hmm.
So they have no weight of salvation on their life, so they can't offer it to anybody.
Exactly.
That's why we've got 8,000 churches in Chicago and in the west side and the south side that could, in a weekend, go and mobilize and bring thousands of people to Christ. But they are more concerned with the church culture and being famous in church and having their name on a flyer than they are about the souls of our sons and daughters. And God is judging that foolishness. He is burning that stuff down around their ankles. And that's why they bring all these fake false prophets in here and having these $1,000 lines, because God is not with them. And we keep going with the hope that what they were once upon a time, they're going to be now. And God has departed from Saul. The spirit is gone. And our discernment won't even allow us to see that these people are falling and God is not even with them. And God is picking people out of the bushes. He's picking little guys in abandoned houses. He's anointing them. But because they don't have the name in the TV program, people don't want them. But God wants them. And that's the remnant that God is raising up right now. People you've never heard about. But they're going to carry the weight and the glory of God. And they're going to cast devils out in McDonald's. They're not going to need an offering to cast your devil out or to get a prophetic word.
Well, I got a question. Then, so with all that we're hearing right now,
yes, sir.
Go ahead, all that we're receiving, we're receiving impartation.
Yes.
What do we do?
Here, baby.
Now, I mean, see, it would be senseless for us to be here tonight, have this gathering, and it happens every Sunday.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And nothing come above it, about it, out of it. Now, everybody's working in their perspective. But what about the whole idea of unity? We've been talking, Prophetess and our church, we've been talking about unity. This needs to be harnessed.
Amen.
This shouldn't happen, and then we leave, and we never connect anymore on what's been said.
Absolutely.
Excellent point. And when God began to, you know, obviously Saul, we see Saul and David. Until that new administration is anointed, I mean, they're always going to be attacked. They were in that cave. They came out. We have to come together. I prophesied last time I was here, and I prophesied many times, that the gatekeepers that are there, Chicago will never change until they're removed. Mm-hmm. Nothing in this city will change. So where does that put us? Very good. We have to come together. We cannot talk. We have to come together and pray. It took three young boys to turn the nation. Mm-hmm. One Nathan to come to David. And he was restored through God's truth, God's word. We need to come together because God, I believe this, that God wants to raise up what is here right now is the beginning, this micro, this nucleus here, to raise up a new general for what God wants to do. Because God cannot deal with greed. And every one of these gatekeepers are filled with greed. They're all in competition. Who got the biggest house? Who got the biggest car? Who's got this? They're all looking at each other. They're liars. I stood there. I stood inside of a meeting with the gatekeepers. And I watched an apostle stand there with his thing and then go through all the motions like someone was already doing it, as he could put it on Instagram or whatever the case may be. I said, this is all theatrics. This is not the anointing. When you're doing a selfie of yourself going like this. This is theatrics. You call yourself an apostle? I'm talking to you. This is not God. When I take something and just do this here and go through all the drama and theatrics. This is what's wrong with the church. Too many clowns in it. Too much acting inside the church.
I'm talking about the, we are talking about the solutions now.
Yes.
What is the key to the problem, to the shootings in Chicago? The gatekeepers, they need to arise. In the Job chapter 5 and verse 12, the Bible says, and the Lord disappoint the devices of the crafty, so that their hands could not perform their enterprises of wickedness.
That's right.
You see, there are many altars in Chicago.
Many.
There are satanic altars. There are all kinds of covens.
That's right.
There are all kinds of grooves, settlements, and habitations. Talk less of spiritual funeral homes. The spiritual funeral homes are more busy. They are more busier than the physical funeral homes.
Jesus.
I am giving a dangerous key that is supposed to be taken crucially. If those altars are not disintegrated, if those covens are not crushed, you are talking about the black market when people got shot and they come and buy spare parts. May the Lord open the eyes of our understanding. You may the Lord open your eyes to see in the realm of the spirit. You see how many planes are coming to Chicago every night, spiritual planes.
Yes.
Go to funeral homes in this south side. I was asking God, show me the gates in Chicago. Show me the altars. Show me the shrines. Show me the covens and show me the grooves. Where they meet at night. Where the witches and wizards meet. Where the blood-thirsty demons meet at night. To drink blood before they manifest physically. You know, these are the things of the spirit. And a carnal man will not understand what I'm saying. But I'm speaking to somebody who understands the things of the spirit.
Yes.
Right.
If you will arise, prayer warriors,
yes,
intercessors, if you can come out of your closet,
amen,
to begin to disintegrate and disappoint all those altars. When those covens are destroyed, when those altars are crushed, when those funeral homes, spiritual funeral homes, doctors are coming from all over the place, spiritually. They are buying parts, human body.
Human body parts.
From human body parts, spiritually. And then physically, when you hear that Mr. A was shot today. No, Mr. A was not shot today.
Yes.
Mr. A was shot about a month ago.
Yes.
Yes.
The funeral has been processed already in the realm of the spirit. And they have distributed his body parts to the various doctors that are coming to take to make money. Occultism.
Yes.
Yes.
Occultism and witchcraft.
Yes.
Occultism and witchcraft.
The fraternal
I am sorry. The Freemasons, some of them are just there. They don't know what is under.
And they're in our church everywhere.
Most of them are there. Occultism to stand tall.
Right.
If the prayer warriors can arise and begin to crush those funeral homes.
The right prayer warriors,
the gatekeepers, to shut down the mouth of the lions, to arrest the strong man, bring him under captivity. The Bible says the weapons of our warfare, they are not carnal, but they have divine potentials to bring down strongholds.
Yes.
It is time.
I want to talk about strategy. Because,
to come out.
I was in the military. I was on the police department. I was a gangbanger. Any type of military organization that's engaged in war has strategy.
They have structure and they have strategy. So to answer your question, Apostle, one of the things that we have to bring back, the first thing we have to bring back is honor. We have to honor each person's personal responsibility to the construct. When I was in the U.S. Army, we had five branches of service, and each one of them had different tasks. There was the Air Force, the Marines, the Army. I was in the Army. We had the Navy, and then we had the Coast Guard. Mm-hmm. Each one of them had a separate part to play mm-hmm. in our military armada.
Amen.
What we have done in the church is we made everybody being an apostle. Mm-hmm. So you got to be a sent one. You got to cast out devils. So we ignore the intercessors. You praying. I'm talking about real intercessors. I'm not talking about the fake church stuff that doesn't amount to anything because you're not listening to God. I'm talking about real intercession where people are actually hearing from God. So we need to honor the fact that he's an intercessor. We need to honor the fact that he's a deliverance worker. And we need to bring him into our church and not wait for him to be famous and have him train our people because our men are coming into the church bound. We need to honor the apostle when he comes and he does apostolic ministry and he trains our fathers. We need to honor the prophet who comes and trains the prophets and begins to develop our churches so we have a full armada of church and not just one stream or one gift. Because that's why the evangelists are missing, because the church has kicked evangelism out the church. We don't need evangelists because we won't honor salvation. We won't honor true deliverance and conversion because most people have not seen it. They've been in a Babylonian church with people who are fake and phony. They've never met God. And so the real weight of salvation, people just don't have a revelation of it. And so as we begin to gather our forces and unify, honor what we do. You do the TV, we're going to honor that. We're going to support that. Your church is going out in February. I'm bringing my whole fellowship, and we're going to do what you do. Because we're training churches to do our outreach. We got a church in Inglewood just called us. We're going to be over there on Tuesdays, training them to do an outreach. Okay, when y'all go out, we're going to partner with Pastor Fisher. We're going to help your church grow. We're going to help their church grow. All this self-serving, you can ask my wife. We have traveled the country. We've trained churches, and we've helped them grow. It doesn't benefit the House of Prayer in Chicago, but it benefits the body of Christ universal. And we got to stop being so self-centered and self-focused, and we've got to engage and honor one another and help build each other's stuff.
Let me just ask something. You know, I think another thing that's so critical is getting people to understand and know who they are is very important, because if you see yourself as a grasshopper, you would never attack the land to kill the giants. You have to understand, and this revelation God gave me from Daniel. Daniel, Bible tells us Daniel prayed 21 days. Fasted and pray. The angel comes after 21 days, and the angel says something critical. He said, from the first day you started praying, I was dispatched to bring the answer. But there was a principality over the whole nation of Persia. Now, listen to this, man of God. The principality kept the angel for 21 days. Now, this is a question I asked God, and let me tell you what the Spirit of God told me. I said, God, I don't understand. How can a holy angel from heaven bring him down an answer to Daniel's prayer? He meets an unholy prince and he cannot pass.
Okay.
An unholy prince intercept a holy angel and the angel could not pass. The Bible said until another angel.
Michael.
Now this is why the Spirit of God told
Chief
me.
Prince.
Only a prince can dislodge another prince.
Strong, only a prince can dislodge another prince.
Every principality over Chicago, if you're not a prince in the spirit, if you don't see yourself as a giant in the spirit, your prayer can have no effect against them.
No effect.
When I go to prayer, I see myself as a prince in the spirit, and I attack the enemy over Chicago as a prince in the spirit.
That's why
only
you don't want to hear your voice.
Can dislodge another prince.
Man of God, that's why they don't want to hear your voice.
Our clock has run down to 00000. And I guess I made the statement before, I'm gonna make it again. It's good when your father owns the company, right? So I guess we overtime tonight, amen. So we're gonna go another 30 minutes. Is that okay?
Okay?
I'm hoping that you are watching and you are being blessed tonight. Listen, we are being truly blessed, but we thank you for tuning in. And listen, it would do us so much goodness here if you would take what you're hearing here and you would spread this.
Amen.
I believe that God has spoken to some of the very things that people have some questions about.
Yes.
And people are looking for true answers. Amen?
Yes.
And so I think what you've seen tonight so far has been truly of God. And I know my spirit bear witness with everything that's been said here tonight. And so I know that if you're watching and you have a heart and you desire for the stirring again of the compassion for souls. Apostle, you talked about fathers. Again, I want to reiterate, fathers have compassion for their children in the natural.
Always.
And even when our children aren't what they ought to be, we still love them and we have a compassion for them. We will go after them if they're in trouble. We go bail them out. Even when they're wrong, we chastise them, but we still love them enough and we bless them. And so that's the same heart that the church needs to have once again. We need to get the compassion. All of the things that you talked about that are going on in the church that is causing things to be subsided. We're not getting the totality of what we're supposed to be getting. The Bible says that we're being conformed to the image of Son, Christ, of God's dear Son. That means the compassion that he had should be growing in us.
Absolutely.
We should be seeking new levels and new realms of compassion, because in our humanity, we're not able. But in the spirit and the Christ dwelling on the inside, we have the full embodiment, compassion of Christ right now. We just have to tap in.
That's right.
Yes. Amen. Amen. We have to tap into what we received when Christ came to live on the inside of us. The Bible said, to wit, Christ was inside of, God was inside of Christ, reconciling the world. That compassion is what, on the inside of him, the totality of God on the inside of him is what helped him. What I'm saying is that we need to begin to consider, we need to do self-examination, assess where we are. Well, a man of God said, you know, how people are holding on to stuff. You know, you have to wonder, if you're holding on to stuff, what was your ministry built on in the first place?
Absolutely.
Did you start ministry to get things, or did you start ministry to honor a God and win souls and advance the kingdom? You know, so if you're holding on to things, maybe we need to go back and reassess.
Right.
Because it's causing a deficiency, not only in your life, but in the people that you've been called to lead. Amen. And I always say people are assigned to our lives before the foundations of the world.
Absolutely, man of God.
Yes.
Compassion is a commitment. So here's what I'm going to commit to. Any church that wants to get trained, whether it be deliverance, church that wants to get trained, whether it be deliverance, intercession, evangelism, building discipleship curriculum in your church, so people are just not sitting there 20 years without being developed, we will come and we will train your church. You can reach out to us at www.dominionvisionglobal.com. You do not have to sit there and allow your church to die. There is help. Psalm 20 says there is help coming from the sanctuary. I can't say I love you and then I don't offer you help. So we're here. We will help. We will help you build. And you don't have to become a part of nothing. There's no strings attached. We're not the mafia. You don't have to pay fees up the ladder. We just want to be able to help you build because God has called you.
Can I stand with the apostle?
Amen. And it's been my friend for 20 years.
I stand with the apostle. I'll come and help train whatever area I can. One of the problems with Moses is it wasn't the spies that came back with the bad report. It wasn't their fault. It was Moses for sending someone that was not qualified to see what they saw. So you have to have strong leaders that know how to choose men that are qualified to see and handle what they hear and what they see.
Yes.
It's very important. This is why disciples, making disciples, raising up the right people, those that are truly qualified, not just a bunch of people that are going to come back and bite you because the wrong people are now complaining to keep the church at bay.
Mm-hmm. Amen. In that vineyard, I will also say that, you know, anything related to prayer, spiritual warfare, intercession, you know, call us, barnabasglobal.com, barnabasglobal.com. That's our website. And we would love to just come, just partner, you know, raising up intercessors, challenging people in spirit. Actually, it's more spiritual warfare.
Hallelujah.
It's not just interceding, but knowing how to fight in the spiritual realm and take your place in the spiritual realm and dethrone everything that enthrones itself. We believe that everything that comes to fight you, God can fight it.
Yes.
Everything that comes to destroy you, God can destroy. Mm-hmm. Everything that comes to oppose you, God can oppose it. Everything that comes to resist you, God can resist it. Everything that comes to kill you, God can kill it. Everything that comes to destroy you, God can destroy it. We believe that, and that's the vision we approach it with. We hit the devil. We hit the flesh. We hit the devil because the devil comes nothing but to steal, kill, and destroy.
Yes.
And we are here to plant the banner of God's righteousness in the city and in the nation. So call us. BarnabasGlobal.com, and we're coming.
On that same note, I am from Joliet.
Where's that?
Joliet. It is an old city. It is an old city in Illinois that has everything that you can imagine. Amen. Joliet has the biggest prison.
Yes.
In Illinois. Yeah. Joliet has the biggest casino. Mm-hmm. Yes. It is characterized with everything that you can imagine. That is where I am. Mm-hmm. I am Pastor Ernest Tabby. I'm a deliverance minister. I have a mandate to set the captives free, to reverse the dead works, and to reconstruct, to build the body of Christ. Only a stronger man can take down a strong man.
Yes.
And say, how can you enter into a strong man's house and spoil his goods? The Bible says you first of all bind the strong man. And I can teach you how to stay on top. In order for you to live a victorious life, number one, you must be a prayer warrior. Number two, you must go deep into the Word of God.
The Word.
And number three, Jesus made it very, very clear. He said, such problems can only go through fasting and prayers.
Amen. Yes.
So if you need somebody to activate the church, to teach the church how to live the life of the Spirit, how to stay on top and to take over the territory and to revive the city, give me a call.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Pull me up on Facebook, Ernest Tabby. Amen. God bless you.
Amen. Bless you.
T-A-B-E.
Yeah, T-A-B-E.
Yes.
They don't want to hear my voice. No, they don't want to. Mm-hmm. Because God has given me the mandate to shut down the mouth of the lions.
Amen.
Yes.
They're Freemasons. They're in trouble.
Yes.
Big trouble.
They're in big trouble. They don't want to hear my voice.
Amen.
Amen.
You know,
Amen.
Apostle Fisher, I really sense this. You know, the television has now become the TV. The phone has become the TV. For everywhere, and I believe that God really wants to use you to reach the world. Everybody, we listen to the TV while we watch television here. The social media, God's going to do something incredible to reach everybody by this piece here. He really wants to bring you to the street, even to film what we can gather together, or going into a churches to do what we have to do to help build what you're doing. And I think maybe that we can get him to follow us and just do something there to televise that. That would help.
On the streets.
On the streets itself. Churches, Apostle.
It is nothing like modeling. When we go out on the streets and we're casting out devils, when new people join our church and they go out on the streets with us, there's a fear that, oh, they're not going to listen to us. But when you take people out on the streets and you minister the gospel of the kingdom, you lay hands, you cast out devils, you heal the sick, you bring people to salvation. Those who never saw it, as soon as they see it, they say, man, this is what we should have been doing all along.
Yeah.
It instantly changes the mindset from fear to faith because someone has enough gumption to model it. People are waiting on us.
They're not fighting
the church. They just haven't seen it.
Right.
As soon as you offer the salvation, as soon as you lay hands and they sense the power of God on your life, they are coming in.
You confirmed. I'm going to come to you because we done shut her out. All
this is her show. It's my show, but this is what God wants. The purpose, mission accomplished.
Amen.
Men, it was for the men to speak.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Now you just said something because I have witnesses here. That's our plan, to take these cameras to the street. And we're going to spend more time, as much time in the church as we do, out of the church as we do in the church, this summer and this spring, going out. Mm. And we're going to take the cameras. We're going to document our souls. We're going to document one soul. We believe that God is going to exponentially bless us in the area of soul winning this year.
Yes.
And we're not trying to do it by ourselves. I have petitioned, I have called for other churches to join with us to win souls for Christ. We all take our resources. We all take our gifts and our talents, and we go out and we win souls for the kingdom. And that's what God, we're training in evangelism every Tuesday night. We got prophetic training. We'll be right back here tomorrow, 6 o'clock a.m. for corporate prayer. And then we're going right into prophetic training. So we're preparing and getting the church ready for the work that we're supposed to be doing. So when God said exponentially, he was just basically telling us, get in position, get ready. And he said evangelism, he said discipleship, and he said training.
Hallelujah.
And that's what he said. And so that's what we're doing. And so this is marvelous. So,
you know, Apostle, every city has a, I'm not sure the language or whatever, but videographer mm-hmm. that comes in and they shoot all the highlights of the city, the nice restaurants mm-hmm. and the sweet, clean park and everything else. Come live in our city, you know, and all these things they show the mayor's office. You need to come into the city and show the opposite and say, come to Chicago, take a look at this, to see those bad areas and those things and see how they'll respond to that.
Yeah.
And the thing is, that's where we need to go into there. Mm-hmm. But all these videographers are making $5, $10, $15, $20,000 just to take clips mm-hmm. on 1 minute or 2 minute clip mm-hmm. of the city and its highlights, mm-hmm. you know? Mm-hmm. So I believe God's gonna use you instrumentally to go into the city where it's not so good, but you're still going to be blessed mm-hmm. because that's where, in that ghetto, that's where the garden is, that's where the wealth. The Bible says there's much oil in the dwelling of the wise, and to break up that fallow ground, mm-hmm. that's where the riches are at.
Yes, that's amen, right. Amen. Well, that's our confirmation.
You see, most people want to go back to Africa. See, everybody want to travel to Africa to go do evangelism.
Yes.
So that when you go there and come back with all kinds of pictures. See, but nobody want to start in their neighborhood. If you cannot defeat the internal enemies, there is no way you can defeat the external enemies.
Amen. 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 Amen.
Yes.
Amen. Amen. Prophet Sandy.
Wow.
Prophet, just please.
Well, as I said before, as an intercessor, this is what God laid on my heart. And so I wanted to see men of God come together globally. I mean, these are my partners, prayer warriors. And like you said, you know, it's time to go to the street. So I believe that, you know, starting even here tonight, that God is, you know, it's a divine connection where you all as men of God will be able to, you know, to network, to work together to start a movement in the city of Chicago.
That's right. That's right. Amen. That's a revolution.
So, a revolution.
A revolution. We need a revolution. Yes, yes, yes. So, now, I want to just we got a few minutes left. We want to talk. We're going to pray.
Yeah.
We're going to have prayer to close out tonight. But just want to talk about the climate and where do you see the church? Now, I know we've said a lot, but to pinpoint some of the things that really need to be done, whether it be the church, whether it be us individually, and what position do you think the church is in right now, considering the political climate, the social climate, all the things that are taking place right now, because we've never really seen a time like this before.
Let me give you the good news, because what has happened in the church, I think a lot of times our narrative gets spoiled by our personal experience. And because we often are limited to where we are, we don't really understand what's happening globally. There's a few good things that I want to share. One, there has been a reemergence of intercessor. I'm a part of the Pray Cincinnati movement. My friend Apostle Peter Griffin in Cincinnati, they get almost 120 pastors every month to gather just to pray. There is no preaching, there is no singing, there is no extrapolation of scripture, none of that. 120 pastors in the city of Cincinnati are gathering just to pray. Pastors.
Mm-hmm. We have that group here, mm-hmm. Men of Faith. Mm-hmm. We meet every month. Men of Faith Network at Paulus High, Trinity Christian Center. Every month, Men of Faith Network.org. Okay. Pastors.
And
corporate prayer every blessed month.
And amen. That's what we gotta let people know, because what people say is, well, there's nobody doing anything. You don't know what's happening. When nobody's out on the streets. We've been out on the streets for 20 years. You just don't know us. Mm-hmm. So there's a prayer movement going. Mm-hmm. There is a church planting movement going. We have young millennials that are building churches all over this country. We know the statistics about pastors who are passing away, they're committing suicide or just walking away, it's 3,300 a year. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, God is touching the hearts of millennials, so we have churches cropping up on college campuses, we have churches cropping up in garages, in car washes, and so God is organically growing his church. Where the church has failed and we've just focused on conferences and stuff, God has went past that and he's beginning to touch the hearts of young people. They're saying there needs to be a revival of true church and true ministry. Wow.
And then lastly, there's been an emergence of marketplace ministry around the world. My brother's talking about Africa. In the next 20 years, Africa is going to be a global power. The African Council of Apostles and the things that they're doing with economic development on the continent of Africa is changing the economic makeup, because the largest churches on the planet are in Africa, but they're just not having churches. They're actually doing things to change the planet. And so we need to know what the good is. We're heralds of the gospel. We know shootings and stuff that's been happening. Cain killed Abel. That was in Genesis. It's nothing new. But the thing is, God is doing something, and we have to get the discernment to understand where God is flowing so we can jump into that flow.
I will say, Apostle Fisher, I think there is a paradigm shift taking place, right? And for me, it's more of looking at the next generation in academics,
yes,
education, and God opened my eyes. God opened my eyes to that man of God when I read Acts chapter 6. Mm-hmm. There was somebody who was in charge of the distribution of the food, mm-hmm. and they were only giving the Hebrew women food and not the Greeks.
Yes.
And it caused chaos. It caused social unrest.
Yes.
Discrimination. Racism. Only Hebrew women got to eat.
Yes.
And the Greek women were believers too, but they were denied. And it caused social unrest. And the apostle said something. He said, choose 7 people who are filled with the Holy Ghost, mm-hmm. faith, to oversee this jurisdiction, yes. this political office.
Yes.
Yes.
So that there will be equity in the distribution of the resources and the wealth, that there will be no confusion and unrest because of discrimination.
Preach.
But they said, but we will give ourselves to the word. In other words, the spiritual leaders will continue doing the spiritual things of praying, interceding, teaching the word.
Yes.
But the members in our church, we got to challenge them in education.
Yes.
Because if God's going to take a corrupt person that is not doing the distribution correct, if God will remove that corrupt person, he has to put someone filled with the Holy Ghost who will distribute it correctly.
That's right.
And so there has to be education. That's why right now I'm doing a PhD in public policy.
Thank you.
Now, I'm not saying that God's going to tell me to leave, you know, what I'm doing ministry-wise. To I don't know what God's going to do with it. Mm-hmm. I just know I got fed up while I seen Africa and all the stuff. And yes. I said, you know what? Let me prepare myself academically that if God chooses you to speak to a university, I can speak.
Yes.
Our kids gotta get engineers, scientists. We need Holy Ghost filled people.
Science, technology, engineering, arts, and math.
Absolutely.
This is where Deuteronomy 8:18 is misinterpreted. What that is talking about is entrepreneurship. Power to get wealth is entrepreneurship. Just that simple. And that's where God is shifting all the leaders right now. There was a big gap between the time of Saul and that time David took it. And this is what's been happening already. And the leaders that exist already are already done. They're already done. It's over with. And God is raising up now for the entrepreneurship, the literacy, the entrepreneurship, all these businesses. He's given us power to create wealth. I mean, everybody in the world, the children of darkness are wiser than the children of us. They own all the businesses, and we're still getting our clothes clean from them. And we don't even own anything. Yeah. You know? So this is what entrepreneurship, and all of this is just opening up the place. They didn't study. They're not full of the Holy Ghost. I'm finishing up a book. It's called Deacons First, Then Apostles. And what I mean by that, until the deacons are put in that position, the apostles cannot do their work.
Jesus.
So it has to be deacons first. And you understand the context of what I'm saying.
Certainly.
Because there's going to be that uproar, that everything else. And it says 7 people. Didn't say 7 black, 7 Mexicans, 7 white, 7 pole. It said 7 men that were full of the Holy Ghost, because they would be unified.
Amen. So let me ask you. So is the church at this point in time deficient of the things that we need in order to carry out what we're talking about? Because, again, once we say it, what do we do next? We have a young lady in our church who's in college, and one of the things we've decided to do, God put on our heart, to make sure that nothing interrupts her education. So I've told our church, send money to her, get a card, put some money on her card while she's in school, so she doesn't have to worry about money. That's the least of her concern. So that's our way of approaching and dealing with that, having been absent before. We have a young lady here now in our church that she came to us when she was 14. She went all the way through school. She graduated. And she's still here, saved, filled with the Holy Ghost, and praying down the walls because she loved God, but because she had the support. So I agree with you. And education also changes the dynamic. It changes the landscape for any individual life, but then for the lives of the people that we're connected to. Just like you said, you want to be prepared because if you get to speak at the university, you have the ability to impact someone's life.
That's right.
And that's the key.
This is the distinction we're talking about. The Babylonian church makes intelligence a lack of faith. You got to believe God. You got to believe God. Mm-hmm. The reason why Paul was able to evangelize three-fourths of the world and write the New Testament was because he was educated. He was a part of the Sanhedrin. He had dual citizenship. He was a Hebrew. He was a Roman. He could flow in different things. He was a tent maker. He was a lawyer by trade. Now, we've got to have a focus and a vision. When these men come to our church, this is why we got into entrepreneurship. My wife was a real estate broker. Okay, we got a young man at our church. He did 17 years. He was a hitter for the GDs. That means he assassinated people for the GDs. He got arrested at 15. They tried him as an adult. He did 17 years in a penitentiary. When he came to our church, he didn't want to hear Haka Mashaka. I'm married with kids. I need a job. We got him a job in a warehouse. They pulled his file. You got a felony. You can't work here. So you know what we did? We put him in business. We taught him how to build his own business. He built a landscaping business. One of my other sons is here. He's working for the post office, killing himself. Man, get out of there. He started his own business. We need entrepreneurship. We need education. People are protesting about politics. You're not qualified to sit in the seat. You don't have the master's in political science. You don't have the PhD, and prayer ain't gonna get you in there. You need to be educated. Faith is not the absence of intelligence. It is the employment of critical thinking. God gave us minds.
That's right.
Go to school, get a degree, start a business. Stop being stupid, believing God. God gave us dominion in the earth. So if it's going to happen in the earth, we're going to do it. When you get prayer, prayer means listening. He that hath an ear, hear what the Spirit is saying. Amen. And if the Spirit is not telling you to increase yourself, increase your capacity, the Bible says when the righteous are in authority, the people rejoice.
Amen. You know, in Luke chapter 4, when Jesus came and he opens it and he reads it, and he said, today the scripture is fulfilled, and he closes the Bible. Let's put it that way. God is looking for men that are going to stop opening the Bible and shut it because they know who they are. And it's time that the church starts closing this book and get up because they know who they are. Nothing can change that. Mm-hmm. We need to come to understand this is what God wants. We're filled with wisdom, knowledge. Understand? We're built with the DNA of God, the fullness of God. Mm-hmm. And it's so important for us to vitally come forth the entrepreneurship that he's given everybody. Everybody has a job, a purpose to do something here. Yes. And we need to start moving on it and bringing these type of things together.
Well, I think that the needs of the church are already met. God has already taken care of that. Again, we reach back into Genesis. Bible says he put them in a garden that was already dressed, already had everything they needed, and then he blessed them.
Amen.
Okay?
Yes.
Then he blessed them.
Yes.
So then Paul tells the Philippian church that my God shall supply all of your needs according to. I don't think we've tapped into the needs. Because when Paul says, my God shall supply all your needs according to my riches and glory, that word supply really means minister to. When you look it up, it means to make. So God says, I will minister to every need that the church has. Well, he already did in Genesis. Mm-hmm. Amen. And we have to come to understand that what we need is already in us. Amen.
Amen.
But we need some people to step up and say, you know what? I may not have achieved what this on this level, but I need to push you and to prepare you and help you and resource you so that you can achieve at a level that I didn't, and keep that process going so that those that come behind us, they reach a much higher platitude in the things of God than we ever did.
Three seconds.
People need that grace to arise.
Yes.
Because it's like there is some kind of an injunction. There is some kind of like a limitation. There is some kind of like a constriction that has kept people from arising. So one of the things we are going to release tonight is the grace. The grace for people to be able to arise and know that God is only moving with those who are moving.
Yes.
God is not stagnant. You are capable of turning things around.
Yes.
What you don't like, you can turn it around.
Mm-hmm.
Don't be afraid to fall.
Mm-hmm.
Don't be afraid to fail. A righteous man will fall seven times, and seven times seven, you shall rise again.
Mm-hmm.
Those that are waiting for you to fall, they will be ashamed if you can arise.
Mm-hmm.
So we are going to pray for the grace, for the courage.
Yes.
For you to arise out of obscurity, out of darkness.
10 minutes. We got 10 minutes, and we're going to end up with prayer, so we're going to give you one more comment, and we're going to open up.
3 seconds.
Sure.
Need is always connected to purpose. And purpose is always connected to relationship. And the thing that we have failed at the most in the church has not been spiritual gifts or office. It's been relationship.
Mm-hmm.
And that will be when we unify. When I love you enough to see your purpose, that's when God will meet our need.
Mm-hmm.
When I look at a drug dealer, I see an apostle. When I see a prostitute, I see a prophet. And so God has supplied my need because my purpose is to redeem
that's
him.
Right.
And that's when the extra supernatural supply of that 5 loaves and 2 fish will come.
Yes.
When we see the hunger in somebody else,
right,
and not what we desire personally.
Right.
And I believe that the restoration of relationship is going to mark this revival that everybody's been praying for.
Mm-hmm.
God is not bringing revival. He's bringing complete reformation.
Yeah.
It's complete reformation.
Hallelujah. Yes.
No revival.
And we're going to push people into their graves.
So let's
amen.
Pray.
Now listen, Pastor Sandy, I'm probably Sandy. We're going to you had wanted prayer, so
yes.
You wanted the gentleman to begin and lead us out in prayer. Listen,
yes.
If you're watching, we're going to we're going to fade out in about 10 minutes. So we want you to stick around for the prayer. We thank you for tuning in tonight. We pray tonight that you have been blessed by this gathering. We're going to ask everyone that is watching, everyone that's in this audience tonight, to begin to pray over this gathering that we've had tonight. And we come against the spirit of retaliation. We come against everything that the enemy will come to do to tear down what God has built up in here today. We pray your strength. We pray that you've heard and that you know what God has spoken to you concerning the things that have been spoken on tonight. And so we believe, God, that there's going to be a great exponential move. There's going to be a move of the movers. And God is going to be the one that's going to facilitate. He's going to provide everything that is necessary in every individual situation. So we're believing for a mighty move of God. We're believing, God, tonight for a revolution to take place, to begin tonight in our hearts, in order for it to reach our cities, it has to reach our hearts first. And so God is stirring something up on the inside of us tonight. We're calling you evangelists to arise again, because the church needs a stirring. There needs to be, again, the compassion for souls like never before. And God is calling on you, and he's calling on all that are watching, all that are here on tonight, and all of those that are around the world that are professing the name of the Lord Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. We join with you on tonight. And we pray and we thank God for your watching. We pray over your life tonight that every need is met. Every supply is met according to the riches and glory that God provides for us, that your assignment would come to pass in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we thank you. Father, we thank you. Hallelujah. Jesus. Yes. Yes.
We thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you for your provision. We thank you for your glory. We thank you for your peace. We thank you for your grace, oh God. God, I pray tonight by the Spirit of God, release your grace. Release your grace. Release your grace. Release your grace to raise us up. To raise up sons and daughters, oh God. To raise up, oh God. To break every limitation. To break every limitation. Raise us up, oh God. In the name of Jesus, raise us up, God.
Yes,
Holy Ghost.
Yes,
Holy Ghost, move.
Yes,
power of God. Activate. Raise our sons. Raise our God. Raise our innocent. Raise our gatekeepers. Raise us up, God. To take over the city. To take over the nation. In the name of Jesus, we give you praise.
In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus.
Grace.
In the name of
Jesus.
Let God arise.
Grace.
Let God arise. And fight for the touch.
Grace.
And fight for the touch.
Grace.
And fight for the touch. Let there be massive deliverance. Let there be massive deliverance. Let there be massive deliverance.
Oh God, deliver the families. Oh God, break the chains. Break the chains. Break the chains. Break the chains. Let that be delivered. Let that be delivered. Let that be delivered. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Let the captives be set free. Let the captives be set free. Let the captives be set free. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Let the captives be set free. Let the captives be set free. Let remove the injunction. Let remove the limitation. Let remove the injunction. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Father, disappoint. Oh God, disappoint. Oh God, disappoint. All the devices. All the devices of the enemies. In the name of Jesus. Father, disappoint.